Good morning, Capitol River Church. We are outside this morning just basking in the newness and beauty of God's creation. And she got us thinking about some things that we wanted to share with you as we get ready to worship today.
I love fall and all the things that it brings, the newness that it brings, the colors, the cool weather, sweater weather. I love the fact that Dunkin' Donuts calls it cozy season. That's really cool. I love its newness in our lives, its beauty, and all the things that it brings. And in Lamentations chapter 3 and verse 22, it reads, "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord." And this scripture talks about God's mercy and that it's new every morning, which is incredible. And just thinking about how many things are new in 2020. It got me thinking about how we get to experience God's mercy in all the things that happen in our lives. We're all going through new stages or new life experiences, like going to elementary school, middle school, high school, or college, having a new dating relationship, new engaged couples, new marriage, newly married, right? Mm-hmm. Or having a new baby. What else? Kids in college that are, well, we have a kid in college. Paying college tuition is new. And also new ways of eating, new haircuts, a new diagnosis in our health. New ways of doing school, new ways of interacting with very close friends or family, or new restrictions on our choices.
Yeah, the list goes on and on and on. And really, some of those things are really encouraging and really beautiful. But some of those things are hard and challenging and raise lots of questions and even doubts. But, you know, just like when the leaves change color and fall to the ground during this time of the year, we still maintain hope that in the springtime, it will return full of life. And similarly, that scripture that Sandy read reminds us that in all of our challenging or confusing new experiences, it is still God's mercy that is present, that we're experiencing. As we even reflect on what we've been learning in our Genesis series recently, we've looked at the life of Joseph, and we definitely saw that some of the new things that he experienced were extremely difficult, maybe even confusing. Why is this happening? Yet we know when we get to the end of the story that we can see very clearly that God's mercy was at play the entire time. And so today, as we come together to worship, even over the internet, yes. Another new experience. Let's be hopeful. And let's be asking God to help us to continue to trust him and help us know that his mercy is indeed what we are experiencing. Let us pray. God, we just want to thank you for all the ways that you wrap your arms around us and take care of us and bless us. And God, even as we go through some things that are challenging, that are confusing, that are just downright hard, that we can be hopeful, that we can know that somehow, some way, we are experiencing your mercies. Be with us today, God, as we worship. Help us, God, to experience your presence. Help us to connect with you. Help us to walk with you exactly what we need so that we can see you more clearly and we can understand your love for us. We love you, we thank you, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hail, hail, line of Judah.
Hail, hail, line of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
In my sin, my life was dead.
In my sin, my life was dead.
I did not often use my head.
I did not often use my head.
I picked up my Bible and I read.
I picked up my Bible and I read.
And then I did the things it said.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How marvelous you are.
thank you for joining us.
Please subscribe to our YouTube channel and check out our website at capitalrivers.org. If you would like to support our ministry, log on to our website and hit the give link.
If you're a member of our church, this is the time we give our offering.
Sings my soul, my Savior God. Good morning, Capital Rivers Church, friends and family. It's great to be together for another Sunday service. What a joy it is to just worship God together. And I know we talk about this every week, but it is challenging to enter this new era of Zoom and YouTube and the fatigue of looking at a screen. So here's what I want you to do right now. I want you to take a second, and we're gonna have a bit of a praise dance break, okay? And what we're actually gonna do is actually during this lesson, we will take one more praise dance break as we are worshiping God together. And if you are a guest with us and you have never done that before, it's all good. We're all learning, but you know, if you need to shake it off, kind of Taylor Swift style, that's okay too. So let's go. 1, 2, 3, praise dance break.
1, 2, 3.
Right. You know, you might be asking, well, where were your dance moves? Well, you know, I'll do a little bit of them. Right? Yeah. Yeah. All right. Cool. So that is it. I'm praising Jesus with my neck rolls. All right. Anyways, welcome to the East region of the Capital Rivers Church. It's great to do this together. It's great to, even if you're joining us for the first time, we have been going through the book of Genesis, and we've been studying out specifically for the past few weeks, Joseph and his life. And Joseph was known as a dreamer, and his dreams brought him to some challenging situations. And as last week, Phil talked about the idea of, come on, God, as he read through Genesis chapter 40. And just when Joseph's life seemed to be turning for the better, something else happened. He caught another L. He took another loss. And it's those moments sometimes that it's so hard for us to hang on to the promises of God when we just take L's, right? So this week we're going to read through Genesis 41. And continue the story. So last week, you'll notice what happened was this cupbearer and this baker offended Pharaoh because they could not do what Pharaoh had asked them to do. And essentially what happened was that these two had dreams that they tried to present and poorly misinterpret to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh had a bone to pick with them. So essentially what they had to do was get a bailout from Joseph. And of course, Joseph had God's ear. He had God's mind. He had the ideas of God being able to help him interpret the dreams that they had. And one thing that Joseph asked, kind of a I scratch your back, you scratch my back moment, was, please do not forget me. And what did they do? They forgot him. So as we're going through Genesis chapter 41, just to summarize a little bit of the beginning part, because it is a big chapter, we won't read all of it. What happens is, yet again, Pharaoh has to, and now the cupbearer has no other choice but to go to the one person he knows has the ear of God to interpret these dreams. So let's continue in Genesis chapter 41, verse 14. It says, so Pharaoh sent for Joseph, and he was quickly brought from the dungeon. When he had shaved and changed his clothes, he came before Pharaoh. He had to show up kind of ready to rock. Verse 15, Pharaoh said to Joseph, I had a dream, and no one can interpret it. But I have heard it is said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. I cannot do it, Joseph replied. But God will give Pharaoh the answer he desires. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, in my dream, I was standing on the bank of the Nile, when of the river then came up 7 cows, fat and sleek, and they grazed among the reeds. After them, 7 other cows came up, scrawny and very ugly and lean. I had never seen such ugly cows in all of the land of Egypt. I would be offended if that were these cows, but then, you know, that's just me. Verse 20, the lean, ugly cows ate up the seven fat cows that came up first. But even after they ate them, no one could tell that they had done so. They looked just as ugly as before. Then I just woke up. Verse 22, in my dream, I saw seven heads of grain, full and good, growing on a single stalk. After them, seven other heads sprouted, withered and thin and scorched by the east wind. The thin heads of the grain swallowed up the seven good heads. I told this to the magicians, but none of them could explain it to me. Verse 25. Then Joseph said to Pharaoh, the dreams of Pharaoh are one and the same. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he is about to do. The seven good cows are 7 years, and the seven good heads of grain are 7 years. It is one and the same dream. The seven lean, ugly cows that came up afterward are 7 years, and so are the seven worthless heads of grain scorched by the east wind. They are 7 years of famine. It is just as I said to Pharaoh, God has shown Pharaoh what he is about to do. 7 years of great abundance are coming throughout the land of Egypt, but 7 years of famine will follow them. Then all the abundance in Egypt will be forgotten, and the famine will ravage the land. The abundance in the land will not be remembered because the famine that follows it will be so severe. The reason the dream was given to Pharaoh in two forms is that the matter has been firmly decided by God, and God will do it soon. You know, a thematic you'll see oftentimes in Hebrew Bible is repetition. And this repetition, as we see even manifested in this dream, shows that if it's repeated, it probably means that it's manifested. It's gonna happen. It's a sure thing. Verse 33. And now let Pharaoh look for a discerning and wise man and put him in charge of the land of Egypt. Let Pharaoh appoint commissioners over the land to take a fifth of the harvest of Egypt during the 7 years of abundance. They should collect all the food of these good years that are coming and store up the grain under the authority of Pharaoh to be kept in the cities for food. This food should be held in reserve for the country to be used during the 7 years of famine that will come upon Egypt so that the country may not be ruined by the famine. You know, what's interesting about this part of Joseph interpreting his dream, not only is he interpreting the dream and showing what's going to happen with the kingdom of Egypt and Pharaoh's reign, but he actually is bold enough to say, hey, here are my suggestions, here are my mandates and how you should govern during this time. Which is a pretty big flex for a prisoner in a dungeon. Verse 37, the plan seemed good to Pharaoh and to all his officials. So Pharaoh asked them, can we find anyone like this man? One in whom is the Spirit of God? And then Pharaoh said to Joseph, since God has made all this known to you, there is no one discerning and wise as you. You shall be in charge of my palace, and all of my people are to submit to your orders. Only with respect to the throne will I be greater than you. Wow. Now, Joseph was in a very vulnerable position. For Pharaoh to ask him, one, it took a lot of humility for Pharaoh. I'd say desperation for him to ask a mere Jewish prisoner what he should do. But man, Joseph, he seized the opportunity. And you know, what's amazing is that Pharaoh, it's almost like a trick. It's a test by Satan, if you will. Hey, are you the one that can interpret dreams? You know, Joseph deflected. He actually repositioned the perspective. He postured himself to say, no, it's not me that can interpret your dreams, but God will make this known to you. You know, there was a reverence to God in this time of Joseph's life that says, look, I'm only a vessel. I am only a tool. And what happened was actually because of the boldness that God gave Joseph, not only to interpret the dreams in a theoretical standpoint, but quite literally, there was a practical suggestion that Joseph made. He said, look, this is what you should do in anticipation of this famine. is to have some storehouse, some kind of a safety net of grain and goods, so that in the event of a famine, we too can contribute in a society that is depraved and deprived of any resources to feed those in need. You know, thinking about the steps that it took, Joseph went through a gamut of suffering. But his gamut of suffering thus led him to what? To this promotion to kingship, essentially to govern over all of Egypt by Pharaoh himself. It's a rags to riches story. You know, we see this theme a lot throughout the scriptures, that the sufferer, the oppressed, now becomes the king, the one who reigns. You know, as Joseph really was, in many cases, a prophetic messianic figure. And yes, his story bleeds Jesus, if you read it right. That Joseph understood that, no, it's not me, but it is the one who lives in me. You know, Joseph, he inherited a crown. And no, not the crown that was given by Pharaoh, though that does come with its perks. But Joseph inherited a crown that was higher than the world that he lived in. Joseph, actually, through his suffering, through the pain, was given a crown that only those that God deems fit and obedient and a willing to abide with him will receive. We too are given a crown. The title of this lesson is The Crown. If you're a fan of the Netflix series The Crown, it follows the life of Queen Elizabeth starting in 1947 and all of those under her lineage. And England's constitutional monarchy is very interesting. And in many ways, it really is kind of more ceremonial in comparison to the monarchy of the kind of earlier stages of England. But the constitutional monarchy gives her the power of being the head of state, but not really a sanctioned ability and powers on all of the ways that the government really does enact policy. But through this story and through the story of the crown, it follows her family and all of the nuanced experiences of their family. And it, like many of those who are in high power, what we see in the tabloids is really just a glimpse of the lives that they live. But following the story, you see the many challenges of being serving under the respected throne. And being given the crown, Queen Elizabeth had a lot of pressure that was put on her. And a lot of pressure that she placed on her children and their children's children. And essentially, we see so many different stories of corruption, of lies, of deception, and of pressure and honor and valor. But all of this starts with a crown. That the crown that was given to them by the constitution that stood is essentially what birthed all of these enacted decisions from every single one of those in power. I mean, imagine being born into a family like this. I think about Prince Harry. And Prince Harry and his current wife, Meghan Markle, are essentially estranged from the family because of differences that they have with the throne. But you're born into this pressure. You're born into this limelight that you kind of feel like you didn't even have a choice to sign up for. Imagine the pressure that you can feel when you're given something you're just not used to. I think the same goes for those of us that decide to follow God. That actually, we need to learn about God's kingship through his lens because we have to unlearn and unpack what society and what our culture actually gives us as a definition of what a monarchy is supposed to be. That a monarchy under Christ's kingsmanship has nothing to do with the ways that the world governs. You know, Joseph was given an opportunity from God. You know, Joseph could have stayed silent, but he picked a suffering path. That Joseph actually could have taken the king's reign under his own hands. I mean, he was trusted by Pharaoh. And you think about all the different moments that he decided to stay truth, to truthful and faithful because of his loyalty to the throne of God. And because of his loyalty to the throne of God, he actually got to preserve his promotion. But if he took it under his own hands, who knows if he would have been actually given an opportunity to suggest, and not to just suggest now, but be given the power to govern over all of Egypt. You know, it reminds me of a passage in 1 Peter chapter 2. And during this time, these people, the disciples that that Peter was addressing in his first letter, they were going through a heap of insurmountable suffering. They were being burned at the stake. They were being made the halftime show at a Roman Colosseum with gladiators going at each other's necks around it. And really, they were made a public spectacle. And Peter was trying to help these guys remember that, hey, you have this crown. My first point is the crown of thorns. You know, we know that Jesus was given a crown of thorns as a mockery of his kingship, that he was the king of the Jews, right? And as the soldiers twisted the crown of thorns on his head, thus driving into his temple, it was a mockery of the high road that he decided to walk. You know, the same went with these disciples. And Peter had to remind these guys, this is why you signed up for this in the first place. And don't forget that you are a royal priesthood. Let's go in verse 4 of 1 Peter chapter 2. It says this, as you come to him, the living stone rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For in scripture it says, see, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Speed over to verse 9. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. You know, for those of us who choose this high road, and no, it's not a glamorous road. No, it's not a perfect road, but it is the path of Jesus that gives us this opportunity. Man, you become royalty. You are given a crown. You get to walk on this road. You get to walk all around those around you with a sense of regality. And not a regality that this society recognizes. You know, you're going to look weak. You're going to look, honestly, insensitive sometimes. Why? Because you are preaching the good news. You know, Jesus, he did offend many. But he did it with love. And granted, Jesus offended probably more of the religious than those who never decided to sign up for one God in the first place. He had a bone to pick with those who lorded their royalty over all of those around them. No, he picked the path of suffering. You know, as Peter is writing to these disciples who are literally being burnt at the stake, he's reminding them that, hey, you know, when you die on that cross, when you're burnt at the stake, you are being promoted again to a royal priesthood. That no, it's not just martyrdom for martyrdom's sake. No, they get to die for a cause with regality, with kingship, with honor, with dignity. You know, Joseph, there's so many ways that this could have gone for Joseph. Joseph could have held back, right? He could have held back the truth. He could have withheld even the wisdom that God gave him to what to do to prepare for the famine that was to come. But no, he seized the opportunity. Why? He knew he was royalty even before Pharaoh gave him the right to govern over Egypt. Now ask ourselves the question. To those who are disciples of Jesus, do you realize you are a royal priesthood? Do you realize you have a crown? Do you realize that you are regal? That man, the color of crimson, the robe that you get to wear is a robe of honor, is a robe of love, is a robe that provides grace even in the face of hatred, the face of disdain. You know, even to reference the crown, a lot of drama happened within that constitutional monarchy. That family member became opposed to family member when they were supposed to be a unified royal priesthood under the house, the Queen of England. You know, in the church, honestly, a ton of us be acting a fool. Oh yeah, me included. You know, I've got to work on my heart. I think there are some challenges that are really hard to talk about even within the church. And I could forget that we are royals together. That some of you that I have some hatred in my heart that naturally can conjure up if I forget that you and I have been given the same crown of suffering. You know, let life be the thorn in our side, not one another. To the disciples, recognize that you have been given a crown of thorns. That suffering is part of what we do. Suffering is inevitable. Not that it's just okay, but man, there are purposes in our sufferings. Even when we feel like, oh my goodness, I am done, I am spent, I don't want to do this anymore, that even those moments are the moments we can tap into the energy of Jesus. You know, Joseph was given the keys to govern over all of Egypt. Let's continue in the story in Genesis chapter 41. And we'll continue in verse 41. So Pharaoh said to Joseph, I hereby put you in charge of the whole land of Egypt. And then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his finger and put it on Joseph's finger. He dressed him in robes of fine linen and put a gold chain around his neck. He had him ride in a chariot as his second in command. And people shouted before him, make way! Thus he put him in charge of the whole land of Egypt. Let's stop right here. Before we continue to read, I told you we're going to do it. We're going to do a praise dance break. But here's what I want you to do. If you are a disciple of Jesus, I want you to dance around like you are a royal priest. That you are a big deal, that you're a boss. So come out and do it with me. One, two, three, praise dance break. All right, come on. I see you. I see you, Pam Luckett. Yeah, yeah. You can dance if you want to. You can leave your friends behind. Great song. But let's continue. Verse 44. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, I am Pharaoh, but without your word, no one will lift a hand or foot in all of Egypt. Just get that for a second. Without your word. Here is an Egyptian Pharaoh relying on a Jewish prisoner. Pharaoh gave Joseph the name Zephanath Paneah and gave him Asenath, daughter of Potipharah, priest of On. to be his wife. And Joseph went throughout the land of Egypt. Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from the Pharaoh's presence and traveled throughout Egypt. During the 7 years of abundance, the land produced plentifully. Joseph collected all the food produced in those 7 years of abundance in Egypt and stored it in the cities. And each day, each city, he put the food grown in the field surrounding it. Joseph stored up huge quantities of grain like the sand of the sea. It was so much that he stopped keeping records because it was beyond measure. Before the years of famine came, two sons were born to Joseph of Asenath, daughter of Potipharah, priest of On. Joseph named his firstborn Manasseh and said, "It is because God has made me forget all of my trouble and all my father's household." The second son he named Ephraim and said, "It is because God has made me fruitful in the land of my suffering." The 7 years of abundance in Egypt came to an end, and the 7 years of famine began. Just as Joseph had said, there was famine in all the other lands, but in the whole land of Egypt, there was food. When all Egypt began to feel the famine, the people cried to Pharaoh for food. Then Pharaoh told all the Egyptians, "Go to Joseph and do what he tells you." When the famine had spread over the whole country, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold grain to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe throughout Egypt. And all the world came to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph because the famine was severe everywhere. Wow. You know, Joseph went through much suffering. He wore a crown of thorns. But now he was given a crown of jewels. You know, as he was given this crown of jewels, he was given resources that he did not have before. He was given resources that he was entrusted with. And what did he do with it? He did much with it. With great privilege, he actually used his privilege to benefit a whole nation. And not even just a whole nation, a whole generation and a whole society because of his wise decisions with what he was given. He was given a wife, entrusted to him by Pharaoh. He was given children. And what he did with the children was he breathed life into their name by not just naming them something cool and something hipster, but no, he named his children to honor God. Joseph knew that with great power came great temptation to do whatever he wanted to do with it or something to do with his own benefit. But no, he used it with great responsibility. You know, all of us, not only when we become disciples of Jesus, are given a crown of thorns, but we are also given a crown of jewels. And that crown of jewels can look different for every single one of us. You know, there's so many examples of those who have used their high power for evil and have exploited and had an obstruction of justice because of their tyranny. And we can go through the whole gamut of history of tyrants that have lived and decorate the pages of our history books. But you know, there are many of those that have been given power, have been in high places, and have remembered the humility that it took to get there. You know, I love stories like LeBron James. Congratulations, he is in the GOAT conversation. But what I love about LeBron is he was just a kid from Akron, right? Akron, Ohio. And he you know, came from humble roots, had a single mom. It didn't really have a lot growing up. But man, throughout his career, he has been very, very intentional about giving back and started the School of Promise. And actually, what's amazing is that they saw their first batch of those who went to his school, and they were doing, all of them, doing well above the average line of success rates in Ohio's education system. You get stories like him. You guys know I love Nelson Mandela. And when he was given power after he literally came out of prison, he created and fostered a society of reconciliation, of talks that were important so that healing could actually be engineered. You know, the list goes on. You know, I think about my countrymen in the Philippines. And many of you know my grandfather who survived a plane crash that killed one of the most celebrated gems and jewels of the Philippines, President Magsaysay. And Ramon Magsaysay really did come from rags. And as he came from the provinces, not with a lot, lived in huts, lived in houses made out of landfill, he used the opportunity that he was given to finally be in a governing position to advocate for those who didn't have enough for themselves. That's why the whole country mourned at his loss, as his tragic loss. And my grandfather spent some time really curating some of the memories, some of the little stories that maybe so many people didn't know about. Why do I share these things? That even these things pale in comparison to us that decide to follow Jesus, to us that are given this crown of jewels. You know, even as 1 Peter 2 talks about the chief cornerstone, you know, Jesus was a jewel. He was the gem that the builders refused to use as the capstone, as the very bedrock of foundation to build their house upon. We know that without Jesus as our foundation, it doesn't matter how fancy our jewelry looks. It doesn't matter how fancy our lives look. It doesn't matter the many blessings that we are given physically. That if we forget who the one that can provide and take away is, that we have no jewel, that we are no gem, and that we squander the wealth that we are given. You know, many of us are put in positions of power without even knowing it. That you're not at a disadvantage. Sure, maybe humanistically, maybe logistically you are, but goodness gracious, you are at an advantage if you have the Holy Spirit of God literally living inside of you. The time is done for us to live in a disadvantage. Look, we're trying to figure out how to even go about even trusting in our leaders. And that goes both politically and even locally amongst ourselves. You know what's so amazing as disciples of Jesus is actually, don't you know that Jesus can govern better than anyone else? That if you have an idea that's amazing, I would ask yourself the question, is my idea from Jesus? You know, what's so cool is the scriptures actually speak to how to love one another, right? How to have grace with one another. How to handle even disputable matters amongst one another. Not to be afraid of those conversations, but how to conduct yourselves with regality that you have the crown of jewels. Let me ask you this. When you consider your role in your community, if you are a CEO, CFO, UFO, no, I'm kidding. You are in a position of power. How are you leveraging that for the gospel? How are you leveraging the connections that you have? If you're a student, you know you do have, you are being put in a position of power. That you are able to speak to people that, frankly, those who are not students cannot. It's just awkward. Imagine you got a 30-year-old guy walking into your high school and saying, hey, kids, want to learn about Jesus? Really cool, but almost sometimes, especially in the society, it would be deemed pretty suspect, right? That don't you know, as a teenager, you have been given the crown of jewels for other teenagers. And the list goes on. If you think about your impact in your community, are you a thorn in the side of people, or are you a gem that deserves to be listened to? Not guaranteeing that people are going to want to hear what you have to say, but do you carry yourself like you actually have something to contribute to the conversation? You know, the world's form of royalty is fighting against ours. It really is. That, yeah, there's some pretty fancy looking kings out there. Some queens that got some strut in their step and some confidence. And to be honest, we can walk around maimed and confused and, oh my goodness, I am walking on eggshells. No, let's change the script. Remember that you actually have something to offer to the famine that is happening in our communities. A friend of mine and I, we walked around Georgetown in D.C. and we came across the Abner Cloud House. And it's actually the oldest building along the Chesapeake Canal and the Ohio Canal. And it's a beautiful historical land site. And what was this place was owned by Millers, and actually Abner Cloud created it to be able to provide for travelers traversing into the waters to purchase flour and grain. And as this house was occupied by very different people over the history of time, what happened was those people that used it for Miller's sake actually provided a lot of grain, a lot of needs and resources for those that were traveling. But throughout the time, oftentimes bandits and criminals actually overtook the house, and they would use that as planting sites. And one of them actually masqueraded as a miller, attempted to kidnap Abe Lincoln unsuccessfully. But throughout the years, after it being unkempt and unorganized and not taken care of, it withered even in foundation. Until the historical society decided to use and restructure the house and to preserve some of its truest to form foundations. And now it's actually used as a meeting place for one of the societies in Washington, D.C. Why do I bring this up? One, it's a really amazing landmark to think about. Man, this is a house that had an original purpose. But sometimes God's house, God's kingdom, God's palace needs some restructuring. That, yeah, throughout time, there can be abuse of power, and we need to recognize that we shall not abuse our crowns. But we're given a crown of thorns to remember that we had humble roots, and we will continue to have humble roots of suffering throughout the years. But actually, that denotes promotion, that we get to suffer just like Jesus. In addition to that, we are provided a crown of jewels, that we too can be a gem to our communities. That, man, let us not shy away from the stories of actually being a vessel to help provide not only for people's lives physically. Yes, let us be the ones to provide solutions for eradicating poverty, for eradicating social injustice, for eradicating all of these things. And also, perhaps the most important, is eradicating the famine of people's souls. Just like Jesus, who had in mind as he looked at the cross, scorning its shame, he looked forward to it with joy. He said the joy set before him, he endured the cross. And as we reflect on Jesus's cross right now, remember, he is the king we follow. And my question to us today, do you remember that you are royal? Will you wear the crown with dignity, with honor, with consideration, and with faith? Or will you abuse the crown and hide in a bunker and pretend like you're at a disadvantage?
Thank you.
Thank you.